For this portion of Perspectives in Public Health, I will provide an introduction to community-based participatory research, referred to as CBPR. I'm Heather Brandt, an associate professor in the Department of Health Promotion, Education, and Behavior, and core faculty in the statewide Cancer Prevention and Control Program in the Arnold School of Public Health at the University of South Carolina. We've made a lot of progress in health promotion and disease prevention. One resource for documenting such improvements are the greatest public health achievements of the 20th century, a list produced by the CDC. On this list are a number of health promotion interventions and strategies that resulted in many lives being saved, better quality of life, an improved number of years of life expectancy. Some of these include reduction in motor vehicle fatalities as a result of seatbelt laws and child safety restraints, immunizations, fluoridation of water, and in most notably in terms of cancer screening, the Pap test for cervical cancer. But overall, we've really failed in the translation of mountains of evidence into actual practice. Public health practice. There are a number of reasons for these shortcomings. One of the main reasons, in my opinion, and the basis for today's lecture on community-based participatory research, is the lack of attention paid to community-level factors. Communities are often not part of the design and conduct of research projects that generate evidence and on which policies are based. So therefore, the context and the realities of living in a community are not taken into consideration. And so one approach for overcoming this limitation of the lack of involvement of communities is community-based participatory research. I've used the term community-based participatory research, or CBPR, but there are a lot of terms in our language and a lot of research approaches, orientations, and methodologies that have similarities to community-based participatory research and served as the foundation on which community-based participatory research is based. Some of these come from feminist traditions, action research traditions, ethnographic traditions, a number of different approaches focused on involving key stakeholders in determining and implementing action in order to improve health outcomes. The evolution of community-based participatory research has been more recently, in about the past 50 years or so, and really resulted as the product of challenged relationships between universities and society, overcoming those battles between academia and the realities of communities. There's a long historical record, especially as I noted, in feminist methodologies before the 1960s, and really led to the culmination of community-based participatory research approaches being put into our vernacular and put into practice, particularly in the past 10 or 15 or so years. We have a long history of various stakeholders being involved in health promotion interventions and strategies and public health in general. And we must capitalize on that long history by further reaching out to and engaging communities in helping to develop the evidence base on which practice and policy are founded. I'm going to take a few moments to talk a little bit about the history of CBPR, including the northern and southern traditions. Two of the major ways in which we can characterize the history of CBPR. The northern tradition had been a practical focus on system improvement, and the southern tradition, which challenges a lot of deeply and longly held belief systems and determining the hierarchy of power differences and how certain sects of society hold knowledge and information that could be beneficial to all. First, the Northern tradition. And I wanted to share with you one of my favorite quotes by Kurt Lewin. No action without research, no research without action. If this mantra prevailed in our normal approaches to biomedical and socially based research, perhaps action would be at the forefront. Kurt Lewin was a professor at MIT, and he first coined the term action research in the mid-1940s, and it first appeared in his paper in 1946, Action Research and Minority Problems. In that paper, he described action research as a comparative research on the conditions and effects of various forms of social action and research leading to social action that use a spiral of steps, each of which is composed of a circle of planning, action, and fact-finding about the result of the action. And in the late 1930s, leading up to this coining of the term, Kurt Lewin and his students conducted a number of research designs in factory and neighborhood settings to show the greater gains in productivity and in law and order through democratic participation of the workers and of those residing in the neighborhood rather than autocratic coercion. Lewin not only showed that there was an effective alternative to management processes that were currently being used at the time, but through his action research, he was able to provide details of how to develop social relationships of groups and between groups in order to facilitate and sustain communication and cooperation to achieve action. In order to achieve these various conditions and relationships that were needed, he focused on identifying objectives of the action and how people could work together through action-oriented approaches to determine how those actions would come about and ultimately and hopefully successfully achieve those actions. So action research is truly a fundamental premise of community-based participatory research in that it starts with an interest in the problem of a group, a community, an organization, a workplace, and its purpose is to assist people who are stakeholders and members of those groups in extending their understanding of their situation and hopefully resolving problems that are confronting them. In terms of the Southern tradition, this has been titled participatory research in nature. And the history of a participatory research orientation has really been around since the 1970s. And this involved a focus on understanding structural underdevelopment and academic distance from social ills. This is that separation, that tension between universities and communities. And this was really related to social determinants of health, thinking about economic opportunity, educational opportunity, housing, where people lived, people in place, and thinking about how to redistribute the inequity that existed in those fundamental determinants tied closely to health in communities through research and researcher relationships, feminist postmodern and post-colonialist voices. So the Southern tradition really emerged later in comparison to the Northern tradition of action research. Both the Northern tradition and Southern tradition serve as a foundation to modern-day community-based participatory research, which has a strong orientation to health, but also in consideration of those social determinants and factors that are closely tied to health and well-being. One characteristic of the Southern tradition relates to participation in the inquiry. And in this quote by Paulo Freire, he is talking about the fact that people's perceptions are their reality, and we must reconcile those perceptions and reality, the subjectivity and objectivity, in order to move forward together and facilitate action and change. Critical pedagogy was heavily influenced by the works of Paulo Freire, arguably the most celebrated critical educator. Freire heavily endorsed students' ability to think critically about their education status because this way of thinking allowed them to recognize connections between their individual problems and experiences and the social context in which they are embedded. Realizing one's consciousness is a needed first step of praxis, which is defined as the power and know-how to take action against oppression while stressing the importance of liberating education. Praxis involves engaging in a cycle of theory, application, evaluation, reflection, and then back to theory. And social transformation is the product of praxis at the collective level. Thus, this has a strong connection to community-based participatory research. Critical consciousness, one of Freire's contributions to our discourse, focuses on achieving an in-depth understanding of the world, allowing for the perception and exposure of social and political contradictions. Critical consciousness also allows taking action against the oppressive elements in one's life that are illuminated by that understanding. So this is that process of praxis combined with considering praxis in context and reconciling those differences between perceptions and reality. One of his major contributions, in addition to critical consciousness, is he emphasized the importance of trusting those people who live in those communities, who are part of those groups, part of those organizations, who are experiencing oppression, to have the knowledge, will, and creativity to solve their own problems, and realizing that they have the ability to do so. Understanding your role and realizing the context of the environment in which you're living and the ability to bring about change is part of empowerment education. And the empowerment education model, another contribution of Paulo Freire. Emancipatory knowledge can lead to having power to make change. That's again, that overcoming and bridging that difference between perception and reality in the context of someone's real life, and being willing to address social change based on that knowledge that one holds and possesses. The empowerment model really starts with conversations, to listen to people who are part of a group or community, organization, workplace, and start coming up with ideas for reconciling the differences between perception and reality and identifying targets for action or social change, and agreeing to set aside differences in some cases and work towards a common goal. That's part of this participatory process, connected to community-based participatory research. One of my favorite quotes of Paulo Freire's is, "Washing one's hands from a conflict between the powerful and the powerless means to side with the powerful, not be neutral." I think this is an important point about working with those who are the most vulnerable, the most underserved, and helping them realize their own power and the importance of their acting on that power that they possess. In order to encourage action, we need to make sure that people are feeling that sense of empowerment and having an opportunity to participate in the process. That process of thinking about being involved and being engaged through participation connects to our theories of how things work and our use of knowledge, and also considering the context of those theories and knowledge in terms of power relations. There are always inherent power differentials among people in groups and positions and the social hierarchy. Think about class structure. And so in order to help people realize the truths of the empowerment model, we have to address these different facets. This leads to CBPR. And this definition by the W.K. Kellogg Community Scholars Program from 2001 is one of the commonly accepted definitions of CBPR. You'll notice that there are words used from the Northern tradition as well as the Southern tradition, with a focus on eliminating health disparities and invoking action for social change, and doing so in a manner that will help allow the understanding that everyone who's interested in social change and eliminating health disparities has something to contribute and bring to the table as part of this process. core principles and characteristics of CBPR as opposed to other orientations to research or other research approaches. One, it's participatory. It's in the title, community-based participatory research. That would imply that there's a group of people, however community is defined. Community can be defined in terms of geography or locale, expertise, experience. Think about the word community and how you might define communities to which you belong. And it's people in those communities who are actively involved in the process. It's also about co-learning, bi-directional learning. So I bring certain things to the table with my understanding of disease etiology and how the public health system works. People in the community with whom I collaborate using this orientation to research, they bring a lot to the table too. They bring the understanding, both subjective and objective, of the realities of their lives being members of a particular community. And I also want to take a moment to acknowledge the importance of balancing research and action. When using community-based participatory research, it's often one of the areas where researchers and communities sort of come to a head, because communities often know the nature of their problems and have ideas about how to solve them, but have yet to realize their own power in bringing about that change. Whereas from a research perspective, we're trying to gather certain information, conducting assessments, trying to more fully understand the context of the community, the nature of the problem, to help lead to informed action. Well, there has to be a blending of that, and that's one of the ways that community-based participatory research serves to help facilitate that process. CBPR has a lot of value in the translation process of getting things that we know work put into widespread practice. And that can be on many levels. That can be on an individual level, family level, community level, larger society, through interventions, through strategies, through policy. And first, it's important to note that our interventions can actually be strengthened with the involvement of communities in that research. And considering community level theories, the community realities, and factoring those into the design. And the participation of community members adds value and hopefully will lead to enhanced real outcomes. Randomized controlled trials are randomized, they're controlled. And those generally don't match up all that well with communities. And so we have to figure out how to use a rigorous scientific approach to engaging communities in the research process, understanding that there will be a lot of differences from one community to the next. And so we have to come up with approaches to take into account those differences and do so in a manner that will contribute to our scientific understanding. Randomized controlled trials are often contrived and artificially imposed on communities. Whereas if we involve community members in the design, hopefully their realities and the context in which they're living are taken into account. So that could help to expedite the process of translation of what works into practice. There are 9 principles of CBPR that have been put forward over the years by Dr. Barbara Israel, Dr. Meredith Minkler, Dr. Jeannie Ng, Dr. Nina Wallerstein, a number of scholars who have worked to strengthen CBPR as a viable research approach and orientation, and to guide the active involvement and participation of communities in the research process. One of the characteristics of the principles of CBPR that really connects with me is the focus on the cyclical and iterative nature of the process. Traditional research approaches, which I'll talk about in a few moments, are generally linear, that A happens before B, happens before C, happens before D. But in communities, it's generally not in that type of order. It's much more cyclical and iterative, which can create challenges on the research side, but the product at the end is very worthwhile. In addition, focusing on that local relevance and considering that local context could really help aid the outcomes and hopefully increase the likelihood of sustaining what works in a particular community. Putting CBPR principles into action can be easier said than done. There are a number of issues developing and following the CBPR principles in practice. This is one of the reasons for the Braun et al. Article that we'll discuss later in the lecture. First off, all 9 principles may or may not be applicable to all implementations of a CBPR process. And we have to decide which principles are most important and to which principles we will adhere. That needs to be discussed up front between the researchers and the community. Speaking of community, we have to be able to define our community to create a sense of boundaries to understand who we're trying to reach and who we're trying to involve and for whom we're trying to achieve social action or address a health disparity. Partners who come to the table during CBPR processes have to be able to recognize each brings different things to the table. And not everyone will be involved in the same way, and we can't expect that, especially when, as a researcher, most of the time I'm paid to do this work, whereas many people in the community are volunteers. And in practice, we try to provide incentives, and those can be monetary, those can be products, those can be different advantages to incentivize participation, but it may not be viewed as the same. And we have to have procedures established up front for how we're going to share information. We want to neutralize the power differentials as much as possible. And one way to do that is to make sure that we have good approaches for communication, that we're transparent, and that we are sharing information that is gathered. Other issues in developing and following CBPR principles can include recognizing and valuing priorities identified by the community. This can be really challenging with funding streams that are disease-specific or community-specific. And I'll talk a little bit more about the importance of working with a community to come up with a research idea. We have to think about the diversity of the partners who are involved and understand that who we are in this process and not trying to impose our belief systems on the community with which we're collaborating. As I mentioned on the previous slide, when talking about policies and procedures, those are important to establish and get down on paper and have an agreed upon understanding of what that will look like in practice. The community has to be actively involved in determining the size of who's involved, and even before the size of who's involved, the types of people that we need to have involved in a particular effort. And CBPR principles don't prescribe a research design or methods. It's an orientation to research where we're understanding that we're going to involve members of the community in the process. And evaluation remains an important component of CBPR in order for us to talk about how CBPR is a scientifically guided approach to research. Dorothy Neiswander is often referred to as the mother of health education. And in talking about issues in developing and following CBPR principles, I mentioned recognizing and valuing priorities identified by the community. And that's exactly what Dorothy Neiswander wanted. She wanted us to start where the people are. Starting where the people are will demonstrate goodwill on the part of the researcher that we're listening to the members of the community. Now, with that said, as I noted, this can be easier said than done because of the nature of how this work is often funded, being very focused on a specific disease. One example of this was shared with me early on when I was learning about CBPR and learning how to put CBPR into practice. One of my mentors was working with the Hispanic community. And she had received funding for a cancer prevention and control intervention working with the Hispanic community. And when she held her first town hall meetings, She heard very loudly and clearly that they were not interested in a cancer prevention and control intervention. They were having trouble with accessing English as second language classes, having trouble navigating the United States healthcare system, worried about making sure their kids were doing well in school and that they were able to get jobs. And so rather than force the issue of the cancer prevention and control intervention for which she had received funding, she went back to the community with an idea and created an English as a second language course that was based on navigating the U.S. healthcare system. So while members of the community were learning English as a second language, they were also learning how to navigate the U.S. healthcare system. And she did that work with them for a while, and she showed in good faith that she was interested in starting where the people are. And leaders of the community came back to her and said, "Now, what was this about the cancer prevention and control intervention?" And she was able to eventually do that work with them. But it shows one of the juxtapositions between researchers working with communities and how this work is often funded, and the importance of recognizing and valuing the interests identified by the community. Earlier, I mentioned some of the differences between traditional research and community-based participatory research. So here's some of those in a two-column comparison between traditional research thoughts and CBPR. Most notably, the community is involved very actively in the CBPR side of things, and we'll take another look at how this plays out in the more traditional linear and chronological order of the traditional research process. So here's that laid out. C on the top stands for community, and across the top is the community-based participatory research approach, and at the bottom is the traditional research approach, and in the middle is the general order of how we think of scientific method. This is from a landmark report from the AHRQ in the early 2000s that really first put out there the viability of CBPR as a strategy for working with communities. So you can see some of the key differences and some of the benefits of having the community involved in the process. It can result in increased motivation for the community to participate when they're helping to identify the key issues, all the way through to enhanced potential for translation and dissemination when the community is involved throughout the process and helps with understanding the data that are collected and participates in presentations and publications. This is a little different than the traditional research approach. And it's not that these are completely isolated or separated from each other, because in CBPR, we're still going to look at traditional epidemiological data, for example. We're still going to think about the science of a design, but we're going to do so through negotiations and in partnership with members of the target community. To apply the CBPR approach, it's important to note that it's an orientation or a process. It's not a method, not a specific method or a set of methods. And CBPR often involves different types of research methodology and many different research designs, sometimes concurrently. CBPR is inherently focused on multi-level interventions, interventions that consider the individual and the community simultaneously. In particular, CBPR focuses on increasing the capacity of individuals within a community, thereby seeking to increase the overall level of capacity in the community capacity. CBPR is also an approach that, when done well, can really result in overcoming potential cultural differences and power differences. A CBPR approach is particularly well suited to four types of research. And a lot of the information in my slides today have come from leaders and scholars in the field, including Dr. Israel, who I mentioned previously, as well as Dr. Minkler, Dr. Ng, and Dr. Wallerstein. So CBPR is able to work on descriptive research, to think about determinants of health, research to understand community needs, problems, resources, and assets. CBPR is inherently asset-directed. Rather than focusing and dwelling on deficits, thinking about what does exist in the community. And that's very similar to a community health development approach. CBPR can also be very beneficial to address health disparities, including factors related to social determinants that drive many health disparities that we see. And as I've already noted, CBPR is particularly relevant to intervention and policy research because of its ability to help expedite the translation process from building the evidence base to sustaining through common practice the beneficial or successful outcomes that emerge. Core components or phases in conducting CBPR really initiate with the forming of a CBPR partnership. This is when the community is defined and gatekeepers or stakeholders have been involved in helping to shape what that partnership looks like. And as you can see, the process is very cyclical and very iterative. Oftentimes, there are a lot of moving parts all at once because we always want to make sure that we're engaging and involving the community, recognizing that not everyone will be involved in all aspects, but that there will be transparency and communication about what's occurring. And throughout this process, it's important to evaluate not only the activities that are occurring, as we might think of traditionally with assessing the impact or outcome of an action, but the process that's happening. How well is the partnership functioning? How well are researchers and community members interacting and working together as part of this process? This can involve a lot of critical self-reflection on the part of both community members as well as the researcher. And oftentimes, this type of work gets conducted with communities that a researcher is not a part. So this is my case primarily. Most of my community-based participatory research experience has been done with the African American community in South Carolina. And when I say African American community, I don't mean to imply that all African Americans can be put into one box. There's a lot of heterogeneity within that community, but I use it to provide a basic definition of how I'm using the term. So this work has happened in the faith-based setting. We've had a long-standing partnership with the State Baptist Young Women's Auxiliary Health Ministry of the Baptist Education and Missionary Convention in South Carolina. We've worked with other church denominations. The church is really a cornerstone of cultural heritage, particularly in the South for African Americans, and continues to be a place for us to partner and work together to address health disparities and the social factors that tie into those. So as you look at this process of how this all happens and think about all these moving parts, you can already start to understand some of the benefits, but also some of the challenges of using this orientation to research. As you might expect, measurement and evaluation are very difficult with this type of approach, but there have been gains made. And a lot of these challenges stem from funding constraints. CBPR is always trying to seek change on multiple levels. There are a lot of moving parts, and community-based participatory research involves a dynamic process. So it's not a randomized controlled trial that's easy to measure individual level outcomes. It's important to make sure that we're capturing those, plus we're capturing the community level outcome measures in which we're interested, and also collecting data on the process that's occurring and the monitoring the implementation of action. And what we've noted over the years and is published in the literature is that there are some characteristics of successful community collaborations. And notice that focusing on process and not merely task achievement is an important characteristic of an indicator of success. So measurement and evaluation remain quite challenging, but they're important nonetheless, especially as we build the scientific evidence base for CBPR as an important approach to addressing health disparities by working with communities that are experiencing those disparities to integrate the realities and context of their lives into the interventions and action. I'm providing a few examples of tools and resources for evaluation, and these continue to be developed and continue to evolve. And one I want to note is the community coalition model. Oftentimes, CBPR has a connection to coalitions who are formed to address a certain issue with various stakeholders. And the fundamental idea behind a coalition is that by groups of people working together, they can achieve more than any one of those groups working individually to achieve the same outcome. And the community coalition model provides a framework for how to do that collaboratively. Dr. Fran Butterfoss, one of the developers of the community coalition model, is a graduate of the School of Public Health at the university as well. Additional examples are available through these two websites that I've provided. The first one includes the Wilder Partnership Assessment Tool, which is a process evaluation tool to be able to determine how well the partnership is working, an important component of process evaluation. The latter is from the CTSA awards that were put out by the federal government. And they're talking about putting into practice these principles of community engagement and some best practices for how to do that. Some important points for your consideration about community-based participatory research. Using an assets-oriented approach, starting where the people are, meeting where the people are, focusing on community solutions to community problems, as Dr. Gil Friedle often says, if the problems are in the community, then so are the solutions, and helping people realize that. Sometimes as a researcher with a CBPR orientation, my role is often to facilitate or coach and kind of stay in the background and not be out front, because I often am not a member of the community with which I'm working. And taking advantage of what does exist in a community rather than focus on what does not exist is a strategy that is consistent with CBPR. If you're considering CBPR as a way to approach research by working with communities, it's really important to understand yourself and know who you are, and being honest about that, not trying to pretend to be somebody different. And being willing to truly listen. And this goes both directions. As a researcher, I have to be open to listening, and the community members with whom I'm working have to be open to listening as well. We have to try to neutralize power differences, and not only neutralize those, but share power. This gets to my earlier point about financial issues, where I'm usually paid to do this work, and community members are often volunteering, despite the fact that we try to help incentivize their participation and reward their participation. Trust is something that once you lose it, you will probably never get it back. And so you have to invest in developing and nurturing trusting relationships, and demonstrating trust, being transparent and being honest are important. This can be a really slow process, not one that happens in just a year or 2 years, or even 5 years in some cases, which are common durations of project periods for grants. And because of the nature of CBPR and wanting to start where the communities are, think back to my example about one of my mentors and her work with the Hispanic community. We have to be able to overcome some of this disease-specific focused funding and time limitations. While I wouldn't describe myself as a patient person, I certainly practice patience as much as possible when approaching a situation in collaboration with the community. Patience is a must. Things don't often happen quickly, and they certainly don't happen on a 9-to-5 schedule from Monday through Friday. And having cultural humility. So this isn't just cultural sensitivity. This is cultural humility, which is a step beyond that, where we're able to acknowledge our own cultural place and the cultural place of the community, and recognizing that we won't fully understand each other's positions, but we can acknowledge and celebrate the cultures that are coming to the table and have cultural humility about this process and take that into account as we're collaborating and moving forward. CBPR has a number of advantages, some of which I've already mentioned, including CBPR is really designed to help address health disparities, expedite that translation process, and hopefully lead to improved health outcomes. Increased participation of members of the community can also be helpful with common study-related problems, including recruitment and retention, therefore decreasing loss to follow-up. We also can help to increase external validity or the generalizability of our work by coming up with approaches that take into account the context of a community. So that doesn't mean that external validity in the traditional sense can be easily transported from one community to another, but perhaps the process by which an action or intervention is undertaken can be applied in other settings. As I also mentioned, we seek to increase individual and community capacity, which is a common outcome from CBPR. And hopefully, by doing this, we're going to increase the sustainability of an action or of an intervention for continued improvements in health-related outcomes. CBPR isn't without its challenges, just as most orientations to research or even research methods are not without their own limitations or challenges. CBPR can be very time-consuming. Relationships have to be developed before a grant deadline in just a couple of weeks, for example. Oftentimes, we make long-term investments in partnering with a community and doing work in order to be prepared for when such funding opportunities come to fruition. Research projects follow a plan, usually from a community assessment to determining objectives, developing the intervention, and collecting data to evaluate the impact. And this can be a really slow process when doing this in partnership with the community. Sometimes there can be discomfort and uncomfortable issues. Race and power relations within the community or between the community and the university, bad experiences with past researchers, all of that has to be taken into consideration. And one of the best approaches is to address that head on. Don't let that continue to be an elephant in the room. And come up with solutions so that both sides can demonstrate their willingness to work through that. And uncertainty. There's an awful lot of uncertainty. This process is as important as the outcomes. It's a cyclical process. Objectives may shift. Things may change. If something doesn't work, we want it to work, and so we're going to make adjustments mid-course, which would not generally happen in a randomized controlled trial. And researchers have to be willing to trust in the process. This is one of the greatest challenges because we have certain deliverables oftentimes and we want to achieve those deliverables. And in this situation, we're trying to come up with a way that we can get it done while still respecting the process that's being undertaken and the true foundation and principles of CBPR in this process. So in conclusion, think of CBPR as a tool to engage, mobilize, and build capacity for improved health outcomes on the community level. Through CBPR, we're building power and working for change, working with those who are the most vulnerable in society. That's one of the reasons why CBPR is so well suited to addressing complex health and social problems. It's important to ensure opportunities for participation. And this means inclusion and representation of all stakeholders as defined and determined by the community. That engagement is essential to making sure that we get the research questions right and the process right. Capacity building has to be addressed through this process. We have to try to increase the skill set of community members, individuals in those communities, in order for them to be able to sustain the efforts once the funding project might end. This is not true for all researchers, as some maintain long-term collaborative relationships with communities. That's in my case. For over the past 10 years, I've been working with the State Baptist Young Women's Auxiliary Health Ministry on projects focused on cancer-related health disparities. We've continued to work together, and I see that continuing for the long term. But there are instances where I've worked in a community with a community, and the project has ended, and the community decided that they were no longer interested or didn't want to do the work any longer, and so there's sort of this natural parting of ways that happens. Of course, there's always the chance that we'll work together again. So CBPR is truly this tool that we can use to help engage, mobilize, and build capacity for improved health outcomes, and is a natural approach to addressing health disparities. This was merely an overview or an introduction to community-based participatory research. In spring 2014, I taught an entire semester-long course on community-based participatory research, delving into the true orientation and approaches that are used, using case study examples, and students in the class actually partnered with communities, all of whom are still working with those communities today. That's an important practical application of how to really learn CBPR while doing it. I was fortunate to have strong mentors who helped me learn CBPR as an orientation while I was practicing it under their guidance. So considering that this was the short version of CBPR and a surface level introduction, think about these discussion questions. First off, how would you explain CBPR to someone who had never heard of it? What characteristics of CBPR might lend themselves to the study of health and social problems that adversely affect underserved communities? So, in other words, how is CBPR relevant to health disparities research? And then think about your public health interests. How could CBPR be applied? For this portion of Perspectives in Public Health, you've been provided with an article to read that goes along with this lecture. The Braun et al. Article from 2012, published in the American Journal of Public Health. The Braun et al. Article is really assessing adherence to CBPR among the Community Networks programs of the National Cancer Institute, the Center to Reduce Cancer Health Disparities. All of the programs were funded and expected to use CBPR as a research approach. This is a process of evaluating the 9 CBPR principles that were discussed earlier in the lecture and determine or examine how these principles were put into action. It's important to note that not all principles may be prominent focuses of all CBPR efforts. But this needs to be negotiated from the beginning with the members of the community and identify which principles are most important. Here are some questions for you to consider after you've had a chance to read the Braun article. What was the purpose of the study? What is the connection of the study to CBPR? How were principles of CBPR assessed? What was the take-home message if all principles were not present? I'll leave you with these questions to consider based on your reading of the Braun et al. Article and based on the introductory information that I was able to provide to you on community-based participatory research. Community-based participatory research is an orientation to research that I believe in. As I mentioned throughout the lecture, I was fortunate to have outstanding mentors who taught me this orientation to research and helped me be a part of their projects and now my own using CBPR. I think CBPR has tremendous potential to help us realize the strengths of a community to solve their own problems, as Dr. Gil Friedel stated. CBPR is an approach that can help us expedite the translation process. So what we learn that works, getting that into communities as soon as possible. And if we start in the communities to develop that evidence base, the likelihood of it continuing to work is greatly enhanced. As Gamecocks, our community has no limits. So think about the communities of which you're a part. Think about your interests in public health, and think about how CBPR might connect to those. I hope that you found this information useful in increasing your understanding of CBPR as an approach to research in public health, considering the benefits as well as some of the challenges. And if you're interested in learning more, I encourage you to take a few moments to examine the CBPR examples that will be provided. I've included examples of three CBPR projects on which I've worked over the years. The first example is Iniciativa Latina contra el Cáncer, or the Latina Initiative Against Cancer, done in partnership with the Hispanic community in the Greater Midlands region of Colombia. The second CBPR example is the South Carolina Witness Project, which was part of the South Carolina Cancer Disparities Community Network, one of those community networks programs of the Center to Reduce Cancer Health Disparities at the National Cancer Institute, and also part of the Braun et al. Article. The South Carolina Witness Project has been a true testament of CBPR in action, such that a statewide leadership team has been formed to take on the tasks of the South Carolina Witness Project and coordinate implementation and evaluation across the state. The third example is the Right Choice Fresh Start Farmers Market, a novel collaboration between the community of Orangeburg, South Carolina, and a federally qualified health center, Family Health Centers in Orangeburg. People who seek care at family health centers are provided with prescriptions for fruits and vegetables available at the Right Choice Fresh Start Farmers Market that's set up right next door to the clinic one day a week. The Right Choice Fresh Start Farmers Market also proved to change state-level policy to allow farmers markets to offer matching funds for supplemental nutrition assistance programs, or SNAP benefits. We created a documentary film about the Right Choice Fresh Start Farmers Market, and I hope you'll take a few minutes to check out the story of the Orangeburg community and the Right Choice Fresh Start Market.